Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. I am very excited to introduce today's webinar, Learn How Danville Area School District Shifted Seamlessly to Remote Learning with WhatsUp Gold. We are joined by some very special guests today, Jeff Ryan, who's the Director of IT over at Danville Area School District, Greg Tittman, who's a social studies teacher and technology lead at the Danville Area High School, and Erin Marshman, who's a first bridge learning teacher and reading specialist at Danville Primary School. And lastly, Mark Towler, who is the WhatsUp Gold product expert and moderator. Today, we are going to start with Mark Towler. So Mark, go ahead and take it away.
Thank you very much, Al. Thank you, everyone, and welcome to our webinar. We appreciate you showing up. I think you're going to find this one very, very interesting. What we're going to tell you is, and actually, I'm not going to tell it. I'm going to leave it up to Jeff Ryan and his teachers to tell you. Really interesting story about how Danville Area School District was able to leverage a variety of really cool technologies to deliver a really exceptional remote learning solution. A piece of that technology, and one of the reasons that we're talking to them, is a product called WhatsUp Gold, which is a network monitoring solution that we make here at Progress. And I'll just give you some background on it so you know what we're talking about. But basically, WhatsUp Gold is a tool that will find every device on your network, show you whether it's up, whether it's down, and how it's connected to everything else through a very simple, very easy to use interface. The main value of this is it allows you to eliminate finger pointing, identify issues that are going on with the network, and resolve them very quickly. It's a very powerful diagnostic tool. The problems we solve: network status, what's up, what's down. You can see this sort of thing at a glance. We have an intuitive mapping interface, and I don't know if Jeff's going to show it to you, but we also have some very powerful and very customizable dashboards, which make it very easy for our users to figure out exactly what it is they need to see at an instant's notice. We can monitor anything that's plugged into your network. It doesn't matter whether that's a device, whether it's a web resource, whether it's a virtual device. If it can talk to your network in any way more sophisticated than two tin cans, a string, we can talk to it, we can get information about it, and we can show you how it's doing. And the main goal of all of this is to let IT teams know the health of their network, and not just let them know when issues occur, but usually to let them know what's happening before things start to get bad. They can see bandwidth starting to hit limits. They can see systems getting stressed. They can see systems starting to go down. And the whole point of this is to allow them to fix problems before their end users are impacted. So when you go into work and everything's working perfectly and the network is up, you don't think about it. That's because there are unsung heroes like Jeff behind the scenes who are fixing problems before they impact you. And the main value of WhatsUp Gold is it allows them to proactively find and fix problems fast. And with that said, it is one piece of how Jeff has been able to develop this really impressive remote learning solution. So with that said, what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn everything over to Jeff to let him demonstrate what he's done, how he's put it together, the other technology he's using, and why his solution has been so effective. We will have plenty of time for Q&A at the end, so stay tuned. I think you're going to enjoy this. Jeff, are you ready?
All right, let's go to it. Thank you, Mark, for the introduction. And I, you know, first and foremost, I want to thank everyone from Progress. It's been an excellent bunch to work with. You know, Hope and Mark and Alexandra and John has made this scenario possible and have been excellent to work with. So thank you to you guys. And then secondly, one thing that you'll hear me throughout this presentation is just how important my staff and everyone that has worked to make this all possible, you know, how important they all are. There's so many people. I hope I get everybody through this presentation that has been part of this, because it is a conceited effort. Originally, conceptually, you know, maybe something that I thought of and put together, but it couldn't be possible, you know, unless everyone was involved, you know, all shareholders, from the administration to our superintendent, first and foremost, Dr. Boyle, our administration, our principals, our curriculum director, Dr. Bickhart, and then, you know, all of our tech staff. And last but definitely not least, our teachers. They're absolutely fantastic and took this head on and have done an absolutely excellent job. So I just wanted to make sure, you know, I started out with that. And, you know, with that all behind us, we'll start talking about virtual classroom. Everyone has their own idea of virtual classroom. And it kind of caught us all off guard, you know, back in March. You know, we've been doing a lot of things in technology and education for a long time. but in last March with the COVID-19 pandemic, you know, really kind of put education on a spot because of the fact that now suddenly we had to be able to teach our kids, you know, virtually at their homes. And it was a tough situation. There wasn't a lot of time. And truthfully, early on, there wasn't a whole lot of valuable education going on because it was just so fast. So, you know, we finished out the year and then everyone started meeting over and over and over again to come up with a better scenario because the uncertainty that was going to happen this fall, and uncertainty is probably a kind word for it. We all, you know, sat down, hunkered down and tried to think of ways. And one thing that our district that wanted to do above, you know, traditional cyber where you put your materials out there and then people kind of self-serve, they wanted to do a virtual environment where, you know, teachers could interact with students and give them a classroom experience at home. And they all turned to me and said, okay, you know, we want to do this, cameras, all kinds of stuff. And at that point, you know, it was a pretty scary moment for me, I got to admit. And what we did was step back, you know, me and my couple of guys that worked for me, you know, took a hard look at it. And they came up with an early solution and we looked at that and it didn't work. And then finally, after some research and seeing what some other people have done, we came up with this solution. And that's basically what this is all about. And the big part of it that I can't begin to stress enough is that the major part of making this work is infrastructure and proactively monitoring your infrastructure. If you don't have a sound infrastructure where you could be reliably doing things on a consistent basis, like we are right now. Right now we are teaching virtually in our school district. We are on this call, I'm doing this webinar at the same exact time. So it shows you, you know, the confidence that we have in our infrastructure. And along with having, you know, a solid infrastructure is, you know, having a great proactive monitoring system. And we use WhatsUp Gold. Originally, you know, when I started my discussions with Progress and we did, it was a case study done on us. You know, I told them right off, I love your product. I'm not saying it because when I'm looking for any recognition or anything of that sort, it's because the product is solid and we use it on a daily basis. And it is the most valuable thing as far as determining when there's problems happening. As of yesterday, this is a scary situation. We had an ISP outage, and it was kind of an odd outage because it was only part of the internet. Something on their head end was definitely wrong, but we were able to determine that there was a problem pretty much instantaneously, and we were ahead of it. Not that we can control what the ISP does to fix it, but ultimately we were able to kind of get ahead of it and put some announcements out to the teacher to kind of quell the panic. Fortunately, our Google Meet and things of that nature were still going, and that wasn't interrupted, but that just shows you one example of how we use it. So I'm going to go ahead and go through my presentation here, go through my slides. So we had a couple operational considerations. You know, first and foremost, can our infrastructure handle and the equipment we had handle the load of what partial virtual or full virtual would mean? And so that was a very important aspect. Number two is, do we have the hardware we need to make it happen? Another essential. You know, if you don't have the right equipment in place, the right tool for the job, that's another problem. And do we have software that is flexible enough to match our needs? As you see later on in this presentation, that was a big, huge point. And can we provide adequate training to make this setup effective and sustainable? You know, one of the biggest things that, you know, I keep saying there's big things, but there's a lot of big key aspects in making something like this work. And professional development in the educational world is absolutely essential. And preparing the teachers and, you know, being a resource for them is absolutely critical. And so that is a big part of what we do. And I'm going to bring in another person that I'm very thankful for, and that's Mr. Breon. He is our curriculum integration specialist. And basically, you know, he worked with the teachers in technology, and he developed some fantastic training materials, and that sets us up ultimately for success. As far as infrastructure goes, to kind of dive in a little deeper, one thing that we do not, we're not afraid to spend money on is infrastructure. Ultimately, you're only going to go as well as your infrastructure and the backbone that you you sit up on top of. So, you know, we have an enterprise firewall, we have enterprise switches, of course, we have enterprise wireless. We have, for a relatively small school, we have a lot of internet bandwidth. One thing that we're going to probably expand upon, and we haven't to this point, is a redundant wireless solution. Right now, we're not at that, and we fortunately, knock on wood, we haven't had any major problems, but we've got to, when we become more reliant on it, we have to have that type of solution in place. And then, of course, the big one, proactive monitoring. Being able to see your latency, you know, have your dashboard up. You know, Mark spoke about the dashboard. That's one of the things that I keep up all the time, and I'll show you that in a bit. You know, being able to see the traffic flow, being able to drill down to see when there's, you know, some spikes, to see where, you know, if there's particular devices that are causing issues, and then, you know, switch issues and just all kinds of stuff. And then another thing we watch, you know, through WhatsUp Gold, you know, on a consistent basis, is wireless itself, to see that, you know, our access points are getting inundated. And we kind of like to spread the load out between our access points and not have any devices that are getting too many clients at one time. So that's one thing that we watch. And then we're very proud here. We maintain, you know, 99% of our stuff in-house, so we can fix it quick. And that proactive monitoring helps with finding those problems and getting those problems taken care of as soon as there's a problem that exists. Our equipment, you know, this is the base equipment for the virtual. Of course, we have a lot more than this in-house, but the big main components, teacher laptop, is you know, the hub of it all. Document camera, web camera, projector, cables and peripherals, the student Chromebooks, and then we have hotspots. For situations where students can't get internet at home, you know, we have a certain number of hotspots that we can go ahead and, you know, deliver out to our students, to accommodate, you know, people that can't either afford them or are in a situation where they can't get it for some reason. So we do that as well, and that's important to have. The base software, of course, you know, WhatsUp Gold's on the top of the list to proactively monitor everything that's happening. Of course, you know, our Windows 10 operating system, which all of our laptops sit on top of, the Chrome OS, the Google G Suite for Education. We are a Google site. There's, you know, there's a couple of other solutions that districts can use. We are a Google Suite, Sites, Classroom. Google Meet is a huge part, of course. It's kind of what runs all of our virtual classrooms. Drive and Docs, we do a lot of collaboration and for virtual learning. And then Gmail for communication. And the big one that kind of stands out in our solution and kind of sets us apart is OBS. And OBS is Open Broadcasting Software, Broadcaster Software. And it's basically been used, you know, for a while now with the gamer community and YouTube live streamers. Kind of an odd solution, you know, for us to use, you know, for in a classroom, because it is open source. But it solved our needs. I mean, it basically, you know, when they asked me, you know, to do this scenario, I'm you know, I was thinking to myself, like, you know, how can we possibly do this? You know, with, you know, they want to, you know, be able to see the teacher and teach at the same time and do all this crazy stuff on it. I'm thinking to myself, how can this possibly happen? And the reality is, you know, they need to have a studio, basically a little TV studio in their classroom to make this happen. And basically OBS allows them to do that. And in its base functionality, OBS is real pretty simple to use. And it can be used just to switch between your sources. You know, your document camera, your webcam, and, you know, your Chrome browser. That, you know, is what OBS is basically used to do in a basic scenario. But then you can expand upon that. There's much more that you can do with OBS and take it to another level. And you can not only do it and switch between them, but the key is, see, you know, it's a quick, you know, seamless type of transition between devices, and I'll show you that in a few moments. But it makes it real easy for you to, you know, be able to switch between those different sources, and it really has kind of, you know, helped us and has made us take off from, you know, in the virtual learning. And just to attest to just how valuable it has become to us, you know, we just had a discussion this morning. You know, we have some things going on at our school district, you know, and, you know, with the uprise in COVID, you know, we have the ability to basically transition from full virtual to, you know, one day on, one day off, to a hybrid. There's a bunch of different things that we can do, and we can do it quickly because everyone knows how to use it, and we can basically switch, you know, from one day to the next if we had to. And that's real valuable coming forward, because there is, you know, a spike right now in the COVID virus. So, you know, there is some expectations that at sometime in the near future, we may be forced to go full virtual. So, you know, the next piece was training. You know, there's a lot of things that we did training wise that helped us. You know, we front loaded our professional development days and started a little bit later. So we could provide our teachers some more time to practice with OBS and with this virtual scenario. So that was huge. You know, we gave them a lot of videos and how-tos, and then of course we did some personal training as well. But it was kind of a la carte. They could go in and pick the trainings they want and watch them. And so we offered them a lot of resources, and ultimately that was a huge part. And then the third part, we didn't have technology leads for a while. And, you know, we decided over the summer that it's a big part. We needed to actually assign some teachers some technology leads so we could give more resources, because, you know, our Mr. Breon, our integration specialist, is just one man. And, you know, there's a lot of people in the district, you know, a good 250 to 300, you know, staff that would need to utilize him. So we selected some technology leads and in from each building to help. And it, you know, proved to be invaluable, especially towards, you know, the beginning when we needed to roll this out and when people needed a lot of help early on. We had those resources. Mr. Tittman, one of the teachers that is a technology lead, is actually presenting today, and he has done a fantastic job. So, as well as every one of our technology leads. So there's another shout out to all of our technology leads, because they have done a fantastic job. So just going through each, you know, piece of software, of course, you know, our host, Progress Software and WhatsUp Gold. Fantastic. I used WhatsUp Gold when I was in the business environment, and it had to have been back in the early 2000s, and it was, still in its infancy. It may have been around for a little while, but I don't think it had been around for that long. In my couple stints, and then when I moved forward from that company, and then went into education, I looked back, looked at other software, and I actually had tried another piece of software. I believe the name of the software was SolarWinds, and that did proactive monitoring as well, but it didn't fit my needs quite as much as I'd remember WhatsUp Gold. So I ended up going back to WhatsUp Gold, and they had actually drastically improved their product, and it was a fantastic addition when I started using it. And after that, I set it all up. It was the ease of use was, to get it all set up and get all my devices on there and get them mapped out and create my dashboard and do all that, was easy to get up and running. I also, do some NetFlow and S-Flow through my firewall and my switches, so I could see real-time traffic. And of course, I have, the wireless hooked into my Meraki wireless solution through a Meraki API, which gives me my information from my wireless as well. So I kind of have, everything I need right there now with WhatsUp Gold. So that's a fantastic product to have, and has kind of helped me troubleshoot problems as well as proactively monitor. And I also have a lot of reports kick out on weekly and daily basis. I'm a real nerd when it comes to data. So I have, all these reports and charts and things, so I can monitor how things are over time, and kind of assess. I'm constantly trying to assess our solutions to try to make sure that I'm doing the best possible and the least interrupt. The way I see it is the least amount of time that people see me, the better I am at what I do. So if there's people out there that probably think, well, what does that guy do? And to me, that's a good thing. And I had a great compliment the other day. I had a teacher come to me with a problem, and I was showing her, we were going over the problem and figuring out what was going on. And she said, I know this is kind of a backhanded comment, she said, but everything works so well around here that when something goes wrong, we like panic and think, that you guys are doing something down there. To me, that's a testament to all the hard work that, I've put in, and all the guys in my team, and everyone in my team has put into it. So that is a great thing. Here's some pictures of, at the top is my dashboard, basically, ping response time, disk utilization, ping availability, everything in here, memory utilization. I watch all that. So if I see any potential problems coming up, I can get ahead of them. On the bottom left, you can see a traffic analysis dashboard showing, my traffic. And I believe that was either yesterday or the day before. There was that drop we had with our provider yesterday. You can see it, in the 12, between 12 and 12:30 time, or yeah, 12 and 12:30 time frame. That doesn't make me happy, but I know when it happens, I can see it. And then on the underneath there is my AP client counts that I watch to make sure that none of my APs are being inundated. Here is, and then of course, a big part of what we do is Google G Suite for Education. I won't get into all of that, but we use Classroom and Google Meet extensively to deliver our content. So now I get to open broadcaster software. So this is kind of the X factor in what we do. It's a free and open source cross-platform streaming and recording program built with Qt. and maintained by the OBS project. And I want to thank them, whoever they are out there, for this product. It's really helped us, deliver some valuable education to students at home. And what I'm going to actually do is kind of the best way to show is go through some OBS functionality. Actually, right now, as we're speaking, I'm using OBS to deliver my video. So if I kind of back out of my presentation here, I am going to show you, I am sharing my screen, showing my Chrome browser, and then I'm going to go ahead and switch to my webcam. So here I am. I'm sorry if I don't always get myself centered, but I'm going to show you how quickly I can switch through these. I'm not used to being, the center of attention. So I'm not used to centering myself. I'm sure the teachers are much better at this. But OBS allows me to quickly, switch from my Chrome browser, which I was on before, and switch over to my webcam. And then I can switch to my document camera. And here's my doc cam on my, on my desk. And the teachers use this a whole lot. This is their actual chalkboard nowadays, because they can project, they have a copy of what's happening on the board for the kids in the classroom, and then the kids at home also see it, through OBS. So it's nice and it's consistent. So, I'm going to do the famous 1 + 1 = 2, just to show you, how smooth and how well it works. It is used heavily. You can bring, objects in. This is our little stream deck I'm using to switch scenes. And I can turn my recording off and things off and program keys for that through OBS. A lot of demonstrations and stuff are also done through the webcam, which is really awesome. And you'll see that happening live here in a little bit with some of our teachers. A lot of teachers also like to have waiting rooms that they put up, and they'll play music and do other things. What's nice is you can put layers in. So if I go back to my webcam, I have, image background that I can put in the background, as well as overlay text. And I can turn things on and off, to show certain things. They can get really complicated, and you'll see that with the teacher demonstrations coming up. Another big one is the Chrome browser. Demonstrate things and do slide presentations and go on the web to demonstrate things as well. And then another part of that is I could throw my webcam down in the bottom corner. This is the power over just standard, Zoom meetings or Google Meet meetings. It's the personal aspect that is added into this whole scenario. So you can see there I am down in the bottom corner. And then, this is my current dashboard of what's happening in the district with my WhatsUp Gold, as well as my traffic. You can see we've already done 600. This is my firewall, 630 gig almost. Oh, just went over 630 gig of traffic already today. We're nearing the end of the day, so the traffic will go down here shortly. And then, of course, this is a look at my client count on my access points. I have a lot more access points, but I watch my heavily used ones just to make sure. I do have one access point here that I can see went over, a client count of 30. So, you know, I'll probably look at that just to make sure that's just not an ongoing problem. But, you know, WhatsUp Gold not only gives you the ability to see these quick views, but then drill down in and look at the details, you know, also as well. So, you know, that's OBS in a nutshell. I mean, you know, you could do other things. You know, I made this little graphic, this silly graphic of me dancing. I can, you know, you can turn things on and off so teachers can pre-make things, bring it in, make things fun. We have teachers that do, you know, waiting rooms with seasonal themes to them with pumpkins. You can also change the shape of the window of your webcam. You can make it in the shape of a pumpkin. It's unbelievable the customization of what you can do with OBS. But that's, you know, and I have another one I'm going to show you quick here. I have my phone. You're going to about to see just how messy my office is. I'm so sorry about that. But it shows how I'm getting buried alive with products. So if I can switch, actually, if I to my phone cam, and hopefully it works on the fly. So here's the webcam, and you can see I've got all kinds of boxes coming in and things, and you can see on, you know, my desk here where I'm at and what I have up on my desk, and there's OBS. So you can do a lot more things with OBS as far as customization. We have teachers using in science using OBS to bring in their microscopes, so the kids at home can actually see the microscopes in action. Some really, really phenomenal stuff. I'm kind of going on a little bit too much here, so I want to kind of jump forward a little bit here. There's two things, you know, or just real quick to show some live shots of some things happening in our district before I move on. And I'm going to present this. And let's take my webcam off. So these are some live shots, some live from video that was done in some classrooms. I just want to show real quick here before we move into our teachers. You know, these are actual slides of the teachers themselves, you know, using OBS. On the board, you could see they have OBS up, so the kids in the classroom see, and you look over on her screen, there is OBS, you know, running, and the kids at home see it. And then in this scenario, our K-5, we have specialists, our specialist help, the K-5 teachers, the hybrid students who are hybrid, they're included in the classroom, but they're at home. So, you know, the teachers jump in to teach specific, areas, ELA and math, and the hybrid teachers kind of control the classroom, and the other teachers jump in on those sessions during the day. In this scenario, you know, the actual hybrid teachers in the room with the teacher. In other scenarios, you know, in this scenario, you can see a teacher is teaching. You can see a webcam up on the left, and you can see, you know, all of, you know, her content, which she has that she's showing the kids. It looks like a math lesson for kindergarten students. And the hybrid teacher's in another room addressing questions and things. So, you know, we need that at the K-5 level, at the high school and middle school, the teachers pretty much control it all. This one here is shows a teacher actually, we had to go full virtual because of some COVID cases in our primary school. And this is a teacher quickly transitioned the next week to going from, partially virtual, jumping in on lessons with the hybrid teacher, to now becoming full hybrid or full virtual with all of her students. You can see the kindergarten kids at home connecting in, which is absolutely crazy that, they can handle this, and they can. They've proved, they learned how to pin and unmute themselves. It's some pretty amazing stuff. And then this is one that shows the science teacher. Bottom left here, you can see her setup with her dot cam, her computer, her laptop, and then they have a spare monitor for her. She has a spare monitor. This is Mrs. Crane. And Mrs. Potter was in the previous video, and I guess I should mention everyone. And then we had Mrs. Rush and Mrs. Bossinger, and then in the second one we had Mrs. Ferran and Miss Hawes. So this is their setup, and Mrs. Crane is one of the ones that uses, right now she's probably doing some kind of chemistry or something of that nature. And she's doing that in her classroom. And then this shows an EL, English teacher teaching. And it's actually the kids in the classroom. And you, to the left here, you can see of her, you can see of the kids at home. And in the high school, we are one day on, one day off. So half the kids are there one day and half the kids are at home. So they teach virtual all the time. So last thing I want to do before I hand it over to our teachers to show some of this in action, I want to thank, my immediate team, Rich Wilson and John Wengren, which is our analysts, and our my assistant director, and then Paul Brian, our integration specialist, Karen Ungst, who's an invaluable resource. She is our administrative assistant. And then Nick Truax, our data service specialist, who is our data guy, but has helped us tremendously through this. So that's all I have for my portion. I'm going to go ahead and hand it back to Mark then to introduce the next person.
Thank you very much, Jeff. Appreciate it. I believe next on deck is Erin Marchman, who is going to give us a demonstration of how she's teaching primary. And Erin, you should be able to present your screen at any time.
Okay, great. So this is my first live webinar, so I'm excited, a little jittery. I do want to start off by saying my background. I'm a Title I reading specialist. I've done that for the past 6 years. So technology is not really, hasn't really been my forte for the last 6 years. So when we were initially presented with using Google Classroom and the OBS, it was very frightening because it was just such a foreign concept. But Jeff and the team did such a great job getting us going and preparing us so that we were ready before we took off, that it has just been pretty much most days smooth sailing from here on out. There's so much to learn and there's so many fun gadgets and different features that I want to use. So I'm still continuing to grow, but it's been invaluable in my position. So again, Title I reading specialist, here I am teaching kids how to read and they're in first grade. So lots of obstacles I had to overcome. Challenges, one, it's already hard to teach children how to read. You don't know what their backgrounds are coming in. And two, here I am teaching them at home through a computer. It's, research and science behind teaching children how to read. It is so vital for them to be able to see your mouth and not just hear noises. There's many components that, again, before OBS was presented to me, I thought, there's no way I could do this. There's no way these little guys are going to learn how to read from home. However, OBS and creating these scenes and being able to switch back and forth effortlessly has not only kept their attention, but also has made it possible for them to learn how to read at home virtually. So with that said, I'm going to start just a typical lesson. I did this yesterday. I'm just going to breeze through it. I always start with an alphabet activity. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to switch my screen to where you're able to see me and also my activity. And my students would have this at home. I would upload all of this on the Google Classroom and they would be able to print it from home and have...
Mr. Reason, 2100, please.
This is us in the live. Sorry about that. Okay, so they would have the resources at home and, you know, I would play a quick little warm-up alphabet game where I would show them, I would pull out two letters and the kids would have to tell me, I would say, what letter is closer to Z? So they would look at the M and they would look at the D and they would have to decide that the letter M is closer to Z. So we would say, okay, M wins that round. And just something like this where we're warming up and we're talking about the letters of the alphabet because, again, this is first grade. A lot of them don't know their letters. So that's crucial to just go over touching and feeling the letters and visually seeing it every day in every lesson. So this game is called Closer to Z. I'm using my document camera to present my alphabet arc and my letter tiles. And I'm also communicating with them so they're seeing my face. You know, and if I needed to switch my screen, if I call on a student, I might say, okay, Veronica, go ahead and tell me what letter is closer to Z. Is it going to be R or is it going to be H? To make it more personal, I would switch my screen so it's webcam. And then I'm using my Stream Deck so that it's a nice quick switchover. And now they're looking at me and they feel like they're more, I'm kind of getting that connection with them. And then I would go back to my document camera. And we would continue with a closer to Z letter activity. So that would be my alphabet activity to get us warmed up. Another feature that I really like with OBS is the waiting room. So a lot of times, you know, before I get started, I'll say, okay, we did our little warm-up activity. We're going to be learning something new today. But in order to get into my classroom, you have to answer the password. This is something I use live in my classroom with the kids. I post it on my door so they don't come into my live classroom until they answer these passwords. Well, I was able to do it virtually as well because OBS has these waiting rooms that Jeff and the whole tech team shared with us. So I might say, here's your first question. How many letters in the alphabet? Okay, Bobby, go ahead and answer. And I show him my face again to make that connection and he'll say, you know, 26. And then I'll go back to my waiting room. And I'll say, great, Bobby, you got it right. Excellent. And we do a little dance. The kids get happy. They see Mr. Jeff Ryan dancing. They don't know it's him, but it is. And then I turn the eye off so that they can't see it again. And then I would present my next question in the class. So I'll take away that question. And then I will show them my second question to get into the class. Because a lot of times I'll have two, sometimes three. Where's my text? We already answered that one. There we go. So I would say how many vowels in the alphabet? And then again, switching back to my screen to make that connection with the students, they would say five. Great job, Bobby. Go back to my waiting room. Maybe make Jeff dance again because Bobby got the answer right. So groovy, they're into the classroom. We warmed up with alphabet and we're now ready to move in and continue learning our skill for today. So another thing that I do in my lessons is a phonological activity, which is another major piece component in teaching children how to read. You cannot teach a skill unless you're able to physically see your mouth. The kids need to see my mouth. They need to see the shape of my mouth. If we're doing a vowel sound, ah, they have to see what my mouth looks like. Otherwise, it's almost impossible to do. So I might say, just to get their attention and keep it fun and active, I would switch my screen using my Stream Deck to the Chrome browser. And I'm going to show them a quick video. I'll show you how I do that.
Like realizing fishing isn't about catching fish, and vacation doesn't mean going.
Stretchy the word snake goes this and that way. Stretchy the word snake loves stretching words. He takes a word like sun, then he'll stretch.
Okay, hopefully you can all hear me again. I'm hoping you heard the video. If you didn't, I'm sure you get the picture. It's a YouTube kids video. They love it. Kind of, it's just an anticipatory set. It gets them hooked and ready to learn on our skill for the day. So it was called Stretch of the Snake. It talks about sounding out the sounds in a word. Jack Hartman, they love those videos. So shout out to Jack Hartman. The next activity I would do is I would switch to my doc cam again. Now, this is really crucial in teaching children how to read and that phonological piece and segmenting sounds. What we do at home, they pull out gems. They have gems. I also tell them you can use whatever you have at home, and pennies work. So I'll show you what we do here. If I were to give them the word sun, they have to be able to see me and say, okay, everybody, say the word sun. And if I really am emphasizing it, I can switch my screen again and say sun and go back to here. And we're going to push the sounds up. So as I'm pushing up my gems, they're also seeing me say the sound. This piece is vital. They have to be able to see me and manipulate the sounds with their gems at the same time. Sun. How many sounds? 3 sounds. So again, that OBS feature of being able to see my mouth while also see my screen using the doc cam is priceless. So, you know, then I would take my whiteboard and say, okay, let's connect sounds, letters to those sounds. We did the word sun. What letter says s? This is something we do. We tap out sounds. So again, they're seeing me tap the sound, and then what says s, that would be the letter S. So them seeing me and seeing me write while also seeing my mouth is a major feature I wanted to highlight with the OBS. So that would be our phonological, what the reading teachers call our phonological activity that we would open up with. Something else I do with them, because I like to try to get them out of their seats and moving as much as possible. OBS really makes that possible because I'm able to switch between scenes just rapidly. If I take too much time clicking, 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 their attention's gone, especially in first grade. So what I would do is switch my screen to the Chrome, and I would say, okay, everybody, I want you to stand up.
Second run buses 35, 51, 64, 38, and 62 are now
Smith. Oh, okay. So if I were doing practicing red words with my kids, I like this with my little clicker, so it allows me to stand up while also clicking at the same time. They would stand up at home, and we would practice something called red words and green words. And we would jump, we would do jumping jacks for says, S-A-Y-S, and they would say says. And we would go through, there's all different activities, okay? If we land on a fun exercise card, we would do star jumps. Again, jumping out our letters and the word to help them with the red words and the green words, while also keeping it active and allowing them to get out of their seat so that they're not staring at the screen the whole time. So, which is great because I'm able to really quickly switch between scenes, and then I'm back at my webcam so that they're seeing me, and there's very little time lost within transitions, again, because of those scenes. So that's a red word activity. Something else I do, I would jump back to Chrome, and we would do something using Google Slides. And this is, again, just trying to make it as interactive. We're talking about open and close different syllable types, and we practice the different sounds of the vowels. This would say I, close it in. It would say I. And again, to make it as interactive as possible, I might say, okay, I'm going to show you a picture. If you hear the short U sound, you're going to pop out of your seat. If you don't, stay still. So this is the word hut. If they hear the they would pop up. Again, they're able to see me as well as the PowerPoint. So they're seeing me answer along with them. So if I say hut, yep, there's an sound. All right, they see me popping up. And it's really great because I'm also able to see my students projected on a screen. So I'm able to see if they're understanding the concept, because if they're sitting down, then they obviously didn't hear that sound. So as Jeff mentioned, having all that software and all those other little pieces put in place is really important as well. One other thing I wanted to highlight with the OBS that has kind of made my life as a reading teacher a lot easier is when we teach a concept, when it comes to learning a certain letter sound or skill. Again, they need to see my mouth so that they can hear the sound, but also see me saying the sound. So I'm going to switch my screen to webcam. I would give them three words. For instance, the word up, umbrella, and shut. And I would say, what sound do you hear that's the same in all three words? And they would say, ah. I'd switch my screen, go back to my PowerPoint. And there's those three words, up, umbrella, shut. So now they're seeing me and they're seeing those words. So up, umbrella, shut. So they're seeing what my mouth looks like when I make that sound while also seeing that U up on the board at the same time, which is really crucial. You know, then we would go up and we would skywrite the short U. One other feature I wanted to close with is switching my camera back to the dot cam and webcam at the same time is when I'm tracing this is something called multisensory that we use when teaching kids how to read. I want them seeing me tracing it while also seeing my mouth making the sound. So I would say, you says, as in up, umbrella. So we have hand motions for the sounds too. Well, they need to see me making the hand motion while also seeing that you, so that it's almost, really is the same thing that they're getting in the classroom. They're still seeing me. They're still seeing their workbook. So that's really important. Again, being able to see it under the camera and also seeing me make the sound with my mouth. And that will kind of conclude my lesson. And that is it. So I'm not sure how to end this, but.
I'll take it from here. Thank you very much, Erin. Okay. That was really comprehensive. It was great seeing you in your natural environment. I believe Greg is up. Looks like he's ready. I'm going to change presenter over to Greg. Why don't you show us how you normally teach your class, Greg?
All right, good afternoon. just have to get a couple things right here. So this is my webcam. You can see sort of with the overlay, I have the circle overlay. I'm one of those people that kind of has messed around with a background image that I can change seasonally. So with the elections coming up, I've got my reminder for my students to go out and vote or remind their parents to go vote if they're not a voting age. Just to give a little background, I'm a high school social studies teacher. This is my 11th year of teaching. I've also taught math in the past, so I have dual certification. And then I'm also the high school's technology lead, which was a position I was just hired for at the beginning of the school year. So in addition to my teaching duties, I also was very front end loaded with assisting other teachers with learning OBS, learning the hardware, the software, and everything else, and getting kind of the school up and running, at least at the high school. So I wanted to quickly sort of show you, this would be my webcam scene. This would be how I would oftentimes start off class, just kind of checking in with students and having a conversation with them before I really get into maybe the lesson. I did want to give you guys a kind of a studio view so you could see what my teaching, what it looks like as I'm teaching. So I have a desktop here with two monitors. This is my teaching monitor. This is how I kind of think about it. So anything that I want students to be seeing, at least in terms of the Chrome browser, that's going to be on this monitor. This is my sort of work monitor. So this is not, you know, shown to the students up on the board. This is not fed through Google Meet with the virtual cam and OBS. So this is where I can keep track of, you know, I have the go-to webinar here, but this would be where I would normally have Google Meet so that I can see my students, I can have the chat open, and I can be interacting with students, you know, via text or you know, if they're raising their hand, I can respond to them. We also utilize a lot at the high school, not a sponsor necessarily, but we utilize Pear Deck quite a bit for delivery of instruction, delivery of lessons. So you can sort of see here, this is the presentation view, but then on the back end, there's a teacher dashboard. So students, you know, this allows you to make your your slideshows, your Google Slides interactive. So I can ask students a question, they can do a text response, there's options where they can draw, there's draggables, so you can drag and drop things onto the screen. And what this allows me to do is on the back end, without showing the students' responses, I can see the answers live as they're coming in and I can respond to students. I also have over here to the right, it's a little bit off camera, this would be where my document camera is, so that I can very quickly and easily transition to using my document camera. So I'm going to walk through, I teach two different preps this year, so I teach economics and world cultures. So I'll sort of show you very briefly how I utilize OBS to seamlessly transition between different scenes based off of the needs of the class. So one of the things we just covered last week were determinants of supply, so things that can impact the supply curve, shifting it to the left or right, other than non-price factors. So I would start off by asking students sort of a leading question. So if the government puts new rules or regulations in place regarding worker safety on the assembly line, will that tend to lead Ford or other automobile manufacturers to produce more trucks or fewer trucks? And so students, you know, would respond in Pear Deck. I would see their responses as they're coming in. I can choose if I want to show the students' responses. So if students were live in the class, their responses would be showing up here. So students in the classroom could see it. And this is also what's being fed through Google Meet for the students who are at home learning online. Now at the high school, we've been hybrid since the third day of school. So we had 2 days of kind of full in-person instruction. And basically since day three, we've had letters A through L have been in person on one day, we call them A days, and then M through Z is in person on B days, and they alternate. So at any given point in time, if I have a class of 24 students, I'll typically have about 12 or so in person, 12 who are online. So the ability to be able to provide education seamlessly so that it is synchronous, it is equitable, it doesn't matter if you're in the classroom or at home, that's what OBS through Google Meet has allowed us to do. So one of the things that I would do is after I ask the students this question, we would go over the definition. So those rules that governments put in place are referred to as regulations. So this would be things like safety regulations or environmental regulations. And then what I would want to do is show students sort of the theory behind it. So what I can very easily do here is using my Stream Deck, you don't have to use one of these, you can also use hotkeys. So I can switch between my scenes going like Alt-W switches to my webcam, Alt-D switches to my doc cam. But the Stream Deck, Elgato Stream Deck, is a way to make that even more seamless. It's just the quick touch of a button and I can transition between my scenes. So anyways, going over here, now I can go and show my students, basically reminding them that the ultimate goal of any producer is to earn profit, and profit is calculated as revenue minus costs, and revenue is determined by the number of products they sell, the quantity times the price. So we are assuming that in this case, all things else constant, ceteris paribus, we're going to assume that price is remaining constant or equal, therefore the revenue earned is equal. So what's the impact of the regulation? Well, if Ford has to provide its workers additional safety equipment, or if PPL has to, you know, have scrubbers installed in their smokestack so that all that carbon monoxide and CO2 isn't emitted in the atmosphere, that's going to add to the cost of production. So anything that raises the cost of production, assuming profit stays or revenue stays the same, should decrease profit. And when there's a loss of profit potential, that's going to cause a reduction or a decrease in supply. So then what I can do is show my students graphically how we represent that in our supply model. So we have price on the y-axis, quantity on the x-axis. There's a positive correlation between price and quantity supplied according to the law of demand. So we show that relationship with a positively sloped supply curve. So in this particular scenario, with the regulations increasing the cost and decreasing profit, there should be a shift of the supply curve from supply one to supply two. So we show that even if the price remains constant, there will be a reduction in the quantity of that good or that service that's being produced on the market. And so that's the result of a non-price determinant such as regulations. So when I'm done with that example, I can then I kind of tried to show you so you can see what I'm doing on the back end. Just click my button over, toggle back over to my slide deck. You know, we provide the definition and then we move on to our next example. So then I would ask students the next leading question and we would kind of continue from there. So that's one thing that's made it incredibly easy with Google Meet, because without OBS, you would have to do all of that through the settings in Google Meet. And it's very, as Erin sort of said previously, it's very time consuming. It's a lot of clicks. This is the press of a button or, you know, hotkey, and bam, you're transitioned over to your next source. So there's very little loss of instructional time. It keeps the students engaged. You're not kind of having downtime. Another thing that I kind of wanted to show while I'm on this is, if students give a really good response in Pear Deck, this isn't necessarily, I mean, you utilize OBS to build these layers on, but what I found is a fun way to sort of show your personality. That's one of the things you lose with online virtual learning, is with them not being in your classroom. Your class is an extension of your personality, so they can't necessarily see your decorations, especially the kids who are full virtual. We have some students at our school district who have elected to be full remote or full online, and so they've not been step foot in my classroom all year. So to kind of be able to show a little bit of the teacher's personality, I have additional sort of features built into my OBS scenes. So I have reactions. So if a student gives a really good answer, I can kind of give them a way to go, good job, or I can give them, you know, yay, right, great job. I can give them Shia LaBeouf clapping, or I can give them Carlton dancing. Not as good as Mr. Ryan dancing. I might have to add that here as one of my options. I don't like having a whole lot of negative things, but if a student gives a wrong answer, I do have a little Patrick from SpongeBob giving a little sad face. I've also, in addition to using sort of the memes and the GIFs, I've also built into my Stream Deck sound effects, so I can give my students, like if they give a great answer, I can give them a round of applause, or I can give them kids cheering. If they give a wrong answer, we could do the sad trombone. Or if I want to ask kids a question and I'm not getting a response, sometimes I'll just jokingly play the Final Jeopardy. And it's just a way that, you know, as a teacher, you can still show your personality to your students. You know, it makes online learning, which is a very not personal, there's very little personal through that screen, through that webcam. It's a way to kind of build some of those connections between the teacher and the student. And those are all things that you can build into your OBS scenes on top of your sources like your Chrome window, on top of your doc cams, which is really nice. Another nice thing I have built into my Stream Deck, this is not necessarily an OBS feature, but I can, if there's a website that I forgot to open before class began, I have a folder here on my Stream Deck. Let me switch over here. I have a folder on my Stream Deck that has commonly used websites. So I have my course website, the district website, Google Classroom, National Geographic, Times, New York Times. So I can, if I forget to open that in the middle of class, rather than having to open a new tab and pull that over, I can literally just boom. With two clicks, I'm at National Geographic. I can, you know, if there was an article I wanted my students to read. So it's about loss of instructional time. It makes things a lot more seamless, those transitions. Speaking of transitions, at the end of class, I also utilize a wait room, a little bit different than the way Erin does it. It's not necessarily like a bell ringer, a way that students enter the classroom, but if I have to step into the hallway so that I can monitor and make sure kids are staying socially distanced and wearing their masks, I want those kids who are coming in for the next class for that Google Meet to know that I'm away from my desk at the moment, but know that I will be right back. So I have a waiting room scene, and you should be hearing the Wild Man of Australia playing in the background. So this is nice with my world culture students. I've been able to feature different international music to kind of expose them to different cultures. And then I have a very long, I have a lunch and a study hall back to back. So for that one, I built another waiting room scene. I am a Penn State grad. You can probably see it on my jacket here. So I have this waiting room scene for students if they join the Google Meet while I'm in the middle of my lunch or during my study hall, because I'm not going to be actively monitoring Google Meet at that point in time. So I have that built in there. And so let me go back over the other class I teach is World Cultures. And one of the things, I guess this is another piece of software that I don't know if Jeff mentioned in his presentation, but in addition to OBS and the virtual cam, which is what we feed the visual feed into Google Meet, we've also utilized Cable A, which is the way to take OBS's audio. So if I open up OBS here in the background, Erin, you could see in Erin's that she was toggling when she went to play that YouTube video. You have to toggle your mic on and off, because if you don't turn your mic off when you're playing, you know, desktop audio, then you get that reverb, you get that feedback. So OBS, but I have a button on my screen deck so that I can very quickly and easily toggle the microphone on and off. The reason this is really important, at least at the high school sort of social studies level, we will incorporate a lot of, you know, in our direct instruction and our lessons, our discussions, we will try to incorporate short video clips to highlight, you know, maybe a topic that we're discussing that day. So in World Cultures, we've just begun our unit on China and discussing sort of its geography. So we wanted our students to be able to complete an activity where we were watching a video clip, but then not having, at the beginning of the year, I guess the concern was with the way we were using Google Meet in the spring, it was near impossible to watch a video live with class because if you tried to just use your microphone, it was terrible quality. The kids on their end just could not hear it. It was really laggy. It was terrible. So we wanted to find a solution so that we could just as easily feed our microphone audio through Google Meet and have our desktop audio feeding through. So we utilize Google Classroom a lot. So one of the assignment for this particular activity was students were going to complete a video guide, answer 6 questions as we watch the video. But I didn't want to just sort of let the kids loose and just say, here, watch this 10-minute video and we'll reconvene, because you obviously lose students when you're not sort of actively keeping them involved and engaged in the lesson. So what this allows me to do is show the video in class and then stop it and then and have discussions live right then and there. And that ability to be able to toggle between my audio source just by turning my mic on and off is huge for that.
Thank you, Greg. This has been really, really fascinating. And I hate to cut you off, but I know we're running a little over our time, and I do want to make sure we've got some time for questions. So at this point, I'm going to throw things open. I know we've had a bunch of questions come in. I'm going to go through the questions we've received so far, and we'll throw them open to Jeff and possibly Greg and Erin, depending if they'd like to chime in and see exactly what kind of answers we get. One question we have here is that COVID forced a lot of schools into panic mode to get better at distance learning. Can you describe your distance learning capability pre-COVID? Did you have a long way to go to get to where you are today? And where did some of the funding for all of this come from?
I'll go ahead and answer that. The reality is, I think, you know, every district was in a bit of disarray in the spring, and there was no exception for our district to, you know, was the same way at that time. You know, it was difficult. You know, we had technology, we've been using it, and it was more along the lines of, you know, to supplement. It's always to supplement. And that's one thing that, you know, is a big theme in our district and always will be. Technology does not drive curriculum in our district. It's, you know, curriculum drives technology. So when the need is there, you know, we come in as a technology group and we're problem solvers and we make sure things happen. So yes, there was problems. There wasn't, you know, we were using straight Google Meet and, you know, in the classrooms, and there was challenges. We weren't prepared for it. Teachers weren't prepared for it. I mean, I my hat goes off to all of them. I want to say thank you to Erin. You know, she did a great job, and Greg, they both did a great job. And you can show you, we have fantastic teachers, and they're both fantastic, and they both, you know, ran with this. They're just two examples of many that have run with this. But it was probably comparable to most districts at that point in the spring. And you know, we knew we had to adjust, and that's, you know, why we kind of got aggressive. You know, most people thought we were kind of nuts for going in the direction we went, but we definitely aren't disappointed at this point that we did, because it's the best thing that ever happened to us.
And also another kind of follow-up question on, do you have multiple schools in the district? And just again, curious about funding. How did this impact your budgets?
Yeah, so you know, our teacher laptops are part of, you know, we have a yearly refresh on our, you know, I basically like that we got to go building by building. So basically, a teacher will have the same laptop for 4 years. So you know, there's no extra cost for the teacher laptop. Same design as we always do. You know, we have the integrated webcam. You know, we're moving into solid state, and maybe a little bit more RAM, because you know some of the complexity of what OBS and some of the things when people are taking it to the next level, you know, we need a little bit more RAM. But that was built in. Chromebooks, our one-to-one Chromebook initiative across the district was already built in, and that's on a refresh cycle. And you know, the doc cams, we've had doc cams in classrooms. We had to supplement some. I would say we only needed about 15 or 20 to complete out what we needed to. So, you know, this solution and, you know, the Google Suite is, you know, free. You know, we're actually, you know, getting into the enterprise version of it for some of the advanced functionality of Google Meet. But the only, and OBS software was free. So budget wise, you know, we really didn't have to do a lot.
And you already had WhatsUp Gold at this point.
Yes.
Got it. Excellent. And you do, and you are supporting multiple schools, multiple campuses with this as well?
Yes. Yes. We have four schools. You saw Erin with our primary school. Then we have an intermediate, a middle, and a high, and they're all in different locations.
Interesting. Does that present any additional challenges?
No, we have, it goes back to infrastructure. We have, leased fiber between our buildings. So, you know, we have a solid connection. It's almost like they're together, but they're not. You know, Greg's schools, I'm in the primary school with where Erin's at, and Greg's over at the high school. And he's just across the lot, but our two other schools are about 2 miles, and then our one school is probably 5 miles, maybe, distance wise. So it hasn't presented a problem.
So just a follow-up question about that. What kind of backup system are you using across these schools? What kind of bandwidth are you using to connect them? And are you taking advantage of any cloud resources, or is this all a physical infrastructure?
The actual district itself, or the connections between, are, it's leased fiber. So we're actually 10 gig between our buildings, and that's done by our switches because it's dark fiber. It's not like community fiber. So we're able to, you know, have the high speed between those buildings. I think, you know, we measured out the company that does our fiber. I think the actual physical length of the fiber between here and our intermediate school is almost 20 miles. But, you know, with modern technology and the way switches work, it's like they're here. So that is not a problem. What was the other part of the question?
Sorry, I was asking, I'm putting too many here together. Are you using any cloud resources as part of your network?
Well, you know, of course, you know, Google is cloud-based. So yes, you know, that is our bread and butter. It's, you know, where the files are stored that the teachers use with the students. And we are transitioning to almost full cloud. Everything that we're doing is trying to move to the cloud, just because, you know, in this virtual environment, we want everything to be accessible anytime, anywhere.
Does that include backups?
Yes, we do have a backup scenario with a backup with a company that is cloud-based. And we also have an appliance on premises that goes with that.
Nice. So did the PSBA provide any guidance or standards that they were looking for districts to follow, or were you guys just on your own?
There was no specific standards that were presented with us of how to do this. I think, you know, the state in general kind of let schools handle it in their own way, because I really don't think they had the time to prepare anything, really. They were probably as much under the gun as we were. So there wasn't really anything provided. Everyone does it in their own way. And I'm sure everyone, you know, does it differently. And, you know, there may be someone out there that does it better than us. you know, it's up to every district, at least in this state, that's how it is.
We have a question about Meraki. Someone was saying they're using Meraki for switches and wireless and firewall, and in the past they could not get much information on backbone uplinks or WAN connections. Do you have that functionality now?
Through WhatsUp Gold?
Yes, I think that's the question.
Truthfully, I haven't, the only thing that I'm using it for, because I don't have the switches. The only thing I use it at this point for is, the access point, the API to get to the access points, and see the detail, the levels of detail that's available through the access point part of it. So, no, we currently don't.
Fair enough. What I can say is I know that WhatsUp Gold does have the capability to provide information and provide data based on everything we can get through the Meraki API. So WhatsUp Gold uses the Meraki API and should be able to feed through and alert on and report on any information that's accessible through that.
Mm-hmm.
Another question was, are there any additional security concerns with so many virtual students?
Well, in, some of the things that we do, with microphones and the way the cameras are positioned. So, that's always, a consideration, a part of this. And it's really something that is, we're always looking at to improve upon. We try not to record, we record through OBS, which is another benefit, because when you record through Google Meet, it will record the students as well, their pictures popping in, their voice. Recording through OBS is nice because you're just getting the teacher feed. So we try to do everything as possible as we can and as responsibly as we can. Realize that there's times where things happen, discipline, of course we have a new level of discipline now, what the kids are doing home on their camera, we had some boys showing off their muscles and taking off their shirts. And so there's all kinds of different things that come into this scenario. So we're kind of, developing those kind of policies and things, and adding to it as we go. Again, the one thing we always talked about, and I know I talked to the progress people about this, but it is, our theme was, building an airplane, in the sky, and I'm sure all districts feel that way, because this is so new, and it's usually you kind of work your way up. Education is a slow moving process, and before you jump into something like this, you go through all kinds of hoops to try to get it. Well, this was one that there was no way you could do that. It had to thrust into it so fast. You're just kind of building as you go, and that's the way. And by no means am I going to say, that this process has been flawless, that there's hasn't been issues, and we work through them. And I think, our group has done a fantastic job and overcome every issue. Like I said, administratively, the teachers themselves are astounding in the way they've worked with this solution.
Well, and that actually leads kind of into my next question, which is, you guys seem to be really advanced. The Danville Area School District was, and I know I'm sure it didn't seem this way to you on the inside, but from the outside, well-prepared, very responsive, very fast. You've gone over exactly how you had the equipment, put the solution together, trained your staff and your educators, and rolled this out, and you're being highly successful. I know for a fact we're going to have a lot of people coming, watching this webinar and going, okay, how did you get so advanced and how can we get there? What's your secret?
Well, I wish there was some magical secret, but, I think it just, as a group, and like I said, I continue, it's something that has to be the buy-in from the top level all the way down, through the whole system. And, fortunately for us, our school board, our superintendent, Dr. Boyle, has been fantastic with moving forward. You know, she's definitely not afraid of trying new things. In retrospect, looking back, you know, right now we're like, oh, this, you know, I'm glad we did this. You know, we were scared, days even before. And Mr. Breon's there listening somewhere, you know, we had discussions, you know, we were leaping into the dark, but we had a lot of confidence in our people around us. We knew that it took a vast amount of preparation. We did a ton of testing on this solution to make sure that it was viable and we wouldn't have crashes on our laptops and things breaking down. And you know, so everything was reliable. So I think, you know, the magic bullet of it all is just putting the work in and being prepared.
So we've been, from a business standpoint, watching everyone who can revert to remote work. And there's been a lot of questions of why haven't we been doing this all the time? And is anyone ever going to go back to the office full time? Are we looking at the future of education with what you've put together, Jeff?
Well, I mean, I think in some aspects we are. You know, we talk about, you know, how do we live without this before? Because, you know, there's some problems with substitutes. We don't have enough substitutes. Now we can have one teacher teach two rooms at the same time, and it's something we utilize already. We definitely see a value in recording our classrooms and being able to, you know, for kids that may have not caught everything, you know, during the day to be able to review it at night. That's another piece of this that we haven't talked a lot about. And, you know, even hybrid kids that, you know, maybe the parents don't show up until night with the smaller, you know, students, because they do have to be involved in a cyber solution. So now, you know, they can come back later at night and help those kids. So I think, you know, it is something that's going to be part of what we do. By no means do we think it's better than in-person learning. There's nothing beats, you know, the personal touch of being there with the students and being able to have that interaction, that you, even though we've come close to reproducing it, actually being in the same room is different. So I don't see it entirely going away. You know, who knows, it may, because it just, our society may demand it. But I do think that this is definitely something that's a game changer and will kind of change the way we think. I know it completely changes the way we think at the school district. You know, we can say at any given moment, it could be, you know, Thursday afternoon, we could say tomorrow we're going to give all our K-5, you know, their Chromebooks, and, you know, our 6-12 have them, take them home already, but we can have them go home Friday night, and then they could be virtual the following week if we want them to. And there's really not much transition wise from the teachers, because they do it every day. So it is changing it around here.
Well, honestly, that's a fantastic example you've shown us, and it's really fascinating. I think we've had a lot of people who are very interested. I know we've gone a bit over our planned time, but I'm going to try and wrap it up here at about 90 minutes. Jeff, Greg, Erin, thank you so much for your time. Thank you so much for all the work you put in on this. We really appreciate this, and we're so delighted to hear and to see what you guys have been doing. It's really, really impressive.
Well, thank you, Mark. It's a pleasure.
All right. Thanks, everyone. I think we're going to wrap at that. Thank you very much for your time, for attending, and we hope you have a fantastic day and a fantastic rest of your week. Stay healthy.